Hi there, I hope you're doing really, really well today. So happy you're tuned in because I think this may be, it's really one of the best, most valuable episodes I've ever made. This is the conversation between myself and Nick Wignall, who is a clinical psychologist working out of Albuquerque. Please enjoy, and I hope you get a lot of value out of this one. Nick, super, super excited to have you back. How are things?
Good. I'm glad to be back. Always a pleasure. All right.
So before we get started here, I just wanted to let everybody know, like, kind of a little bit of the serendipity of this happening. So there's this one, and you too, Nick, I know we shared it with you, but not maybe the full story, but there's somebody that I've been emailing back and forth from the YouTube channel who said to me, asked me a question about anxiety. And I said, you know what, I really wanted to reach out to Nick, but I hadn't done it. But she made me like send you a message, Nick. And it was just kind of generic, like, hey, Nick, you're interested in coming on. And then you went, yes, and I want to talk about anxiety.
Yeah.
And I thought that was so serendipitous. So without further ado, like, you mentioned you had kind of a theory about like insomnia is more of an anxiety disorder.
Yeah, I tend to ruffle a lot of feathers when I say this, but I'm of the belief, clinically speaking anyway, that insomnia is, it's not really a sleep disorder. It's an anxiety disorder. And that's a little provocative, I think, to a lot of people, because it's, insomnia is about sleep in a lot of ways. But I think a really key thing to understand with insomnia, this doesn't apply to other sleep disorders like apnea or restless leg syndrome. There's a lot of different types of sleep disorders. But when it comes to insomnia specifically, there is nothing physiologically wrong with your body when you have insomnia. And I think it's like and you're an MD, right? So you can back me up on this.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree 100%.
But it's something a lot of people don't know. People who have struggled with insomnia for years or decades and seen dozens of doctors and read every single article on the internet, and they're shocked, like mouth drop shocked, when I tell them, there's literally nothing wrong or abnormal or pathological with your body. Your body knows perfectly well how to sleep. It, just like your body knows how to breathe, your body knows how to sleep, and it wants to. The issue, like all anxiety disorders, is getting out of our own way. And so we can dive into that a little bit more, but it's the fundamental kind of premise is that physiologically there's nothing wrong with your body in insomnia. And I just think that's so important to kind of get a handle on. We'll talk more about the implications of that, but, I'll throw it back into your court. You have thoughts on that?
Absolutely. Like, before we go on here, first of all, you know, what you're telling me, I believe it 100%. I know it to be true. And I guess nobody said it as clearly. So when you say it that way, I'm like, I can see how it can be hard to swallow for a lot of people. But going back to that, when you say ruffle a lot of feathers, is that meaning like in kind of the psychology or medical community or for people with insomnia?
I think both, certainly for professionals, other professionals. But I would never say that kind of straight up to my clients, especially not in the beginning of working with them, because it is kind of jarring. It's sort of a jarring, brash thing to say. But it really does kind of make people stop and kind of reconsider their overall perspective and thoughts about, you know, what is going on here? The fact that I'm really struggling to sleep and I feel like I'm not getting as good a sleep as I need, and maybe I'm not sleeping as much as I would like, does it really follow that necessarily there's something wrong with my body physiologically? Or could there be something else that's getting in the way of me getting the kind of sleep that I would like that would be good for me? And I think what that often leads into is a discussion of how are, you know, other parts of you, your kind of your mind in particular, and your behavior as well, how is that getting in the way of good, healthy sleep, which is what, again, what your body wants to do, what your body is perfectly capable of doing on its own. And so this naturally leads into the conversation about anxiety and sort of our habits of thinking and behaving and what those habits kind of do to our system, especially our sleep system. So does that kind of make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense 100%, totally. And I have a couple of like follow-up thoughts on that. But did you have another thing that you wanted to say?
No, go for it.
Yeah. So I feel like when you kind of present that idea, I think a lot of people will have, I feel like, I'm sure you get this too, a lot of people are resistant to that idea, meaning it's hard to get people to stop believing that there is this hormonal imbalance, there is a neurotransmitter that is too low, or they have some type of brain dysfunction or something like that. How do you do that kind of like, how do you lead people to explore the belief that maybe there isn't something wrong?
Yeah, well, there's a lot of different approaches to that. But one thing to really point out, and when you work with people and you kind of track, get them to track their sleep and really kind of think a little bit more carefully about their sleep, what they realize is, everybody does sleep. You will get sleep if you're literally sleep deprived for too long. Like you know it. Things go very, very wrong very quickly. There's plenty of research that shows that people with insomnia, on average, underestimate how much sleep they get by over an hour.
Yeah.
Which is pretty wild. So, yeah. What I look to is their own experience with sleep. And how much are they really sleeping? And a lot of times what you'll find is people, one night they only get 4.5 hours of sleep. Right. Mm-hmm. And then another night they get like 5 hours of sleep, and then they have two really awful nights of sleep. And understandably, you're going to be really focused on those, but almost inevitably what happens is that's followed by another night of like 7 or 8 hours of sleep. So with it, the typical pattern in insomnia is it's extreme fluctuation between periods of a relative lack of sleep, but then also normal amounts of sleep. So even people with insomnia are capable of getting long, good stretches of sleep. It's just not as consistent as they would like. Whereas if there's something really kind of broken in your body, that wouldn't be as possible. So that's kind of one way to get at that. There's lots of different ways you can start to broach this topic, I think. The way I go next with this in kind of getting people to think more about the role of their mind and their mental habits and actually anxiety in sleep is I go to my whiteboard and I kind of draw this line, a long horizontal line, and I say, all human beings, our level of activity kind of falls on a spectrum. And on the far left, you can think of extreme inactivity, like when you're unconscious, right? If you're in a coma or if you're sleeping or if you're knocked out, something like that. Very, no conscious activity. And then working up from that, there's relaxation. You know, think about you've been lying on the couch for a while. You're, watching some kind of mindless TV show. You could easily kind of fall asleep. You're in a very low level of activity. Then there's sort of what you might call like arousal, right, or activation, which is like the normal level of activity in our day, right, where we're active throughout a day. We're checking emails, we're in conversations, we're, just kind of doing stuff, running errands, going to the grocery store.
Right.
But then we also have this high gear where we can kick into, it's like turbo, when you're on the freeway and you really need to pass someone, you can really punch it. Our body has this aroused state where we can really punch up into high gear for brief periods of time. That's really helpful, right? If you're, out hiking and you're getting chased by a mountain lion, you really want to be able to kick it up into high gear, right? Of activity. And the thing to realize, I think, is that sleep happens when you move from relaxation into sleep. I mean, sleep is the last level of activity. There is no activity, right? But you can't go from turbo mode into sleep. It doesn't work that way. So I get people all the time who are, they're checking emails, they're doing chores around the house, they're working on projects, and then all of a sudden they realize, oh my gosh, it's 11:30, it's bedtime. And they lay down in bed and they look at their clock and it's been 5 minutes. And they're like, why am I not sleepy? How come I'm not falling asleep right now? Because you've been in turbo mode for the last hour and a half. Like, your mind isn't gonna go down that quickly. It takes time to kind of downshift into a lower level of activity, right? So that's really important, that relaxation is the doorway to sleep. You can't go from active or aroused to sleepy any more than you can go from sixth gear at 90 miles an hour to park. Like your transmission is going to fall out of your car if you try and do that. It just doesn't work, right? So you have to slowly transition through these different phases. Now, this is important for anxiety because by definition, anxiety is arousal. It's that high level of it's physiologically, it's fight or flight. It's adrenaline. Your fight or flight system, your sympathetic nervous system is kicking into gear, which is your body's turbo mode. When it thinks your survival is on the line, it kicks you into turbo mode, right? And we can get ourselves into turbo mode, into arousal, into anxiety, even if we're not really in danger. So a way this commonly happens is people who have had struggles to sleep, and it can come through a variety of reasons. Maybe some people have an illness that really makes sleep hard for a while. And then they've experienced how awful it is to not get enough sleep on a regular basis, you know, to really struggle with their sleep. And it is rough. Like when you have a few stretches of suboptimal sleep, like you feel terrible. And there's a way in which people can have what I sort of think of as sleep trauma. Like if you've ever had an experience where you've had a long stretch of pretty bad sleep, it can really kind of scar you, it's natural to always kind of have that looming like on the horizon. Now, the problem is if you get into bed one night and you start worrying about, oh my God, well, if I don't, it's been 20 minutes, I haven't fallen asleep yet. And I have the big presentation tomorrow. What if I only get 5 hours of sleep? I'm going to be a disaster tomorrow. If my boss is going to be there? And before you know it, you're in turbo mode.
Yeah.
You're up into arousal and anxiety. And you just can't fall asleep if you're in turbo mode. So that's why I say it's really about physiological arousal at the end of the day. But it's this weird quirk of human psychology and behavior that we can put ourselves into turbo mode when we don't really need to be in it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And one of the best ways to do that is to get to worry a lot and get really anxious. Go ahead.
No. I was going to say, the 100% agree with everything you said. I think the analogy with turbo is like, you can totally understand. I often talk about like hyper arousal, hypervigilance state. Turbo makes total sense. I think somebody who hears this is going to probably think like, oh, okay, I think I get it, but how do I get out of it?
Yeah, it's a great question. Admittedly, it's a really hard question because thinking hard about anything increases your level of arousal.
Exactly.
So even if you don't go into turbo mode, if you're relaxed, you're on the couch, you're watching Netflix, you're getting sleepy, your eyelids are getting heavy, and then you get into bed and you realize, oh my gosh, it's 20 minutes later than I had planned to go to sleep. Uh-oh, like what if this messes with my sleep? What if I end up waking up in the middle of the night?
Yeah.
You're understandably concerned and trying to kind of figure out a problem. But there's this paradox where the more you think about it and the harder you think about it, the more genuinely you analyze this problem and try to figure it out, the more aroused you're making yourself. The higher you're putting yourself into progressively higher gears of arousal and activation.
Exactly.
And it doesn't mean anything like nothing terrible is going to happen. It just means it's going to take longer for your body to downshift and get back to relaxation. So there's this really paradoxical thing with sleep, and it's the same with anxiety, which is why I think of it as an anxiety disorder, which is you can't really think your way out of it. So if someone has a spider phobia, everybody in their life for years has been telling them that spiders aren't dangerous.
Yeah.
And in fact, they've been telling themselves that spiders aren't dangerous. They know that. It's not an intellectual problem. But the way you get over spider phobias is you prove to your brain experientially that spiders aren't dangerous. You expose yourself to them and you give your brain the chance to learn experientially that you're not going to die. Nothing bad is going to happen when you're around spiders. It's not an intellectual problem. The same thing is true of sleep. I think your body knows perfectly well how to sleep, but if you constantly worry about and think about sleep as a problem, you're kicking yourself into a higher level of activity, which is doing the exact opposite of what you want to do. So the not so easy key is to sleep really well. And this is if you take the best sleepers in the world, what you'll notice about all of them is they don't think all that much about sleep.
Zero effort, like
zero effort. Yeah, sleep effort. We talked about that in the last time we talked. Yeah. So, how do you do that? How do you stop thinking? Well, if you tell yourself to stop thinking, that's just more thinking, right? So there's a bit of a paradox here. So what I have found to be really helpful, and it's a similar approach that I take with my anxiety clients, is it's actually more about behaviors and habits and routines.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a little bit general, but let me give you an example. So for that person who's got in bed and realized, okay, it's 20 minutes after my bedtime, and they can feel themselves starting to worry, right?
Yeah.
The temptation is, okay, I just listened to that podcast about how you're not supposed to worry about sleep. So stop worrying, brain. You know, stop it. Stop it.
Exactly.
Like, no, you're not going to talk your way out of anxiety. You're not going to convince your brain to stop being anxious. What you need to do is change your behavior, right? So put yourself in a different situation, in a different context where it's harder to worry. It's incredibly, I mean, if you wanted to design a situation that is optimal for worrying, it would be in your bed late at night.
Yeah, exactly.
Dark.
In
your bed.
There's
no stimulation. You're not moving at all.
Yeah.
All you have to do is think, right?
Yeah.
So this gets at a lot of techniques that are called stimulus control, which is a technical term, but it essentially means put yourself in a situation where worry is less likely, uh-huh. right? So you know what? Okay, you got into bed and you're not sleepy. You were, but you're not. It's a little disappointing. You might get a half an hour or an hour less sleep than you wanted. But you know what? You can function actually fairly well on an hour less sleep. So get up and go watch another 20-minute sitcom until you start getting sleepy again. Don't try and make yourself less anxious. Do something that will result in you being less anxious. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it totally does. And, I typically say, like, you need to kind of distract yourself, like, you know, keep your mind off sleep. And I think you'll agree with me with this one, is like, and when you do that thing, let's say you decide to get out of bed and you watch it in 20 minutes more of Netflix or something like that, I think it's important that you're not doing that in the purpose of that making you sleepy, right? Because then it becomes a sleep effort.
Right. And this is really the importance of habits and routine. So what I tell people is you need a game plan for if you get disruptions to your normal kind of sleep schedule.
Mm-hmm.
So we should decide ahead of time, and I do this a lot with my clients in the therapy room, is let's create a playbook. Like, if you ever watch professional sports, like football is the classic example, you see the head coaches on the sidelines and they have these one sheet, like laminated sheets that they carry around with them.
Yeah.
It's not the full playbook. They have a full binder that's like hundreds of pages long, but it's the most essential strategies for a given period. So if all of a sudden it's fourth down and two with, you know, 5 seconds left on the clock, they've already thought ahead of time, okay, there's a few best plays that we want to run in that situation. So here's my cheat sheet. I don't have time or the energy to like think through all the options. I'm just going to have a game plan ready to go so that when I find myself in that stressful situation, I don't have to think too much about it. It's right there. So it's the same with sleep issues, right? If you know that you have this problem of, I tend to get in bed, and even if I was sleepy before, I tend to get a little bit anxious when I get into bed about sleep, what's my game plan? Have an algorithm so that you don't have to do any work, any intellectual work or thinking. There's just a program that's already set up. You just kind of follow the rules, you know? So like, for instance, if you get into bed and you find yourself wide awake again, worrying about sleep, your program is just to go watch another sitcom on Netflix until you start to get sleepy again. And then you get back in it. There's no decision making. There's no, well, this time it's different because, you know, if this, then this, and what about this thing? And no, you just have, you have a rule and you just sort of follow it. That way you're not thinking more about sleep and you're not trying to fall asleep. You're just following the playbook.
This is great. It totally resonates with really good practical advice. And, you know, I want to sneak this one in here. You know, when you said that about like the football coach, and I was like, Nick, you should write a book called Insomnia Playbook and be like super practical advice like this one. I think that would be amazing. Now, getting more practical again, like we mentioned, like I'm totally like you. Like I don't think it's a problem if you are watching a Netflix show or something like that. I think the most important thing is, like, again, distraction, not thinking about sleep. And so do you, are you kind of on my, do you agree with me that you're not too worried about the blue light and like that type of thing?
Oh God, no.
To hear that.
If you really read the research on, I mean, it's really illuminating. You have to do some work, but if you really read the research on blue light, the effects are tiny. If you want to be concerned about blue light, you should be concerned. There is some evidence that suggests for kids, blue light exposure late at night is pretty impactful on their sleep. But for adults, and especially for middle-aged and older adults, the effect is negligible, like tiny, tiny, tiny. And so even if this is the one I love to kind of shock people with, I say, let's say you watch TV in bed, which is like the cardinal sin for any sort of like sleep hygiene thing you read online or you hear from a doctor or something. Even if you are getting this like surge of blue light late at night, I guarantee you the impact of that on your sleep is tiny compared to even a few minutes worrying about your sleep.
Wow. Exactly. Wow. Yeah. You said it.
Anxiety, worry about your sleep is going to kick you into turbo mode way faster and stronger than the blue light you would get from watching 20 minutes of Seinfeld or something.
Right.
So you can't take these things like blue light is bad just in the absolute. The question is, well, bad compared to what and how bad? And with blue light, it's the effect is pretty small, so it's really not that bad. And it's always relative to, well, what's the alternative?
Exactly.
If someone's just going to lay in bed and worry about not sleeping for 30 minutes, it is way better for them to watch a TV show and allow their mind to kind of downshift into active and then relaxed and then be able to kind of slide or fall into sleep.
Oh my gosh, I'm so happy to hear you say this. I totally believe it. And even within the like insomnia community, a lot of people are like, you know, that's why when I asked you, I approached you very gently, but I'm 100%, I believe that exactly what you're saying. And listen, before I forget this, I have a couple more things, but there was Zimi, you know, the person that kind of made me reach out to you. She had a specific question to you. So she said this, when you talk to Nick, would you mind asking him what he thinks of treating anxiety first, then CBTI for insomnia, if the source of anxiety is the insomnia? Oh, interesting. I thought she was going in a different direction. But let's say you have somebody that has both insomnia and anxiety. Yeah. You know, how would you approach that?
I think you can treat them together because fundamentally, I think they're the same thing. So here's a classic example. When I take someone who has a lot of anxiety just in general, but also a lot of anxiety about their sleep, one of the best, most practical things anyone can do for that situation is a technique that's called scheduled worry, which was actually originally designed for, it was used as an intervention for generalized anxiety disorder, but it's used by a lot of CBTI providers now because it's so helpful for anxiety around sleep. And what it means is it's pretty straightforward. Let me start with a quick metaphor real quick.
Sure, I think
this really helps.
Yeah.
So if you, we just got a new dog. And if anyone who's got a new dog knows, if the dog isn't potty trained like a kid, it's gonna go potty everywhere. So if you have a dog in your backyard, it's gonna poop all over the place. It's gonna poop on the lawn, it's gonna poop on the deck, it's gonna poop on the sidewalk, it's just all over the place, which is not what you want, right?
Right.
So how do you train a dog to not poop on the grass? Well, you can like whack its nose with a newspaper or something when it poops, but then it's just gonna move over to the other part of the grass and poop there, right? By just like yelling at the dog or trying to explain to a dog why pooping on the grass is not okay, it's not going to work, right? How do you train a dog not to poop on the grass? Well, you pick a place in your yard where it's okay for the dog to poop and you positively reinforce it for pooping in that place, right? So you bring it out to that one place, you wait for it to poop, then you give them a treat when that happens, right? Or praise or whatever. So that's a weird, slightly gross metaphor, but it's actually the same thing with sleep. And anxiety. So people who worry a lot about their sleep, their worry is like it's like their intrusive sort of little arousal bomb that just kind of bombard you all the time, right? And you can't combat those sort of like little bursts of arousal and anxiety directly. what you have to do is you have to train your brain to stop throwing anxiety at you all the time. And you can't do that by talking to it. You can't do that by fighting with it. You do it by training something different, something more helpful. Mm-hmm. So what that really looks like is you pick a time during your day, usually kind of the early evening is the best, not right before bed, but maybe kind of after you have dinner, early evening. And you schedule it for 10, 15, maybe 20 minutes, but a specific hard and fast amount of time. So say 15 minutes. And you pull out a sheet of paper and you set a timer for 15 minutes. And your goal, your sole goal, is to worry as hard as you can for 15 minutes. You every single worry you can think of, from what you need to get at the grocery store the next day to, you know, the meaning of life, or the fact that you're, you know, worry about what's going to happen if you don't sleep well tonight.
Yeah.
Every single worry you can think of, you get it down onto paper. You just write it down. It can be in list format. It can be kind of like a journal entry, whatever. But you just like brain dump all of your worries down into that period, including your worries about sleep. Then when your timer goes off and your time's done, you stop, you put it away, and that's your worry time. Okay. Now the trick with this is it's not going to be super effective as a one-off. You can't just do this once and hope to not be anxious anymore. It's a habit, just like training your dog. Mm-hmm. It's about training and creating new learning, new habits. So if over time, and usually if you do this consistently, it usually takes about a couple weeks, a week, maybe 2 weeks. But if you do it every single night, what you'll find two things. A, when you actually do get into bed, you're not going to be bombarded as much by worries and all the anxiety that they produce.
Yeah.
But what you're also going to find is if you do get hit by anxiety and worry, it's going to be easier to acknowledge them and redirect to say, you know what, that's okay. I realize that's sort of an irrational fear. It's not something me worrying more about that isn't going to help me at all in this situation. So I'm going to kind of put it away and I'll get back to it at my scheduled worry time.
Exactly. Right? Yeah.
So it's training your brain. Instead of saying stop worrying, brain, you say, go ahead, brain, worry during this period of time. Yeah. And what that implies is not during these other times. So scheduled worry, which is counterintuitive, right, that you would worry on purpose, is actually a really effective habit to help with anxiety and sleep worry and anxiety in particular.
This is great. And I you know, I've heard about this technique before. I talked a little bit about it, but what I really love how you're putting it is like those 15 minutes, yeah, your goal, your target is to worry as much as you can, like, you know,
yeah,
really get it out, right?
Right. You want to approve that time for worry. Your brain is used to you fighting against worry.
Got it. Yeah.
But if you say, yes, worry, bring it on, let's do it right now, it's going to really learn, okay, this is the time to worry. And it's going to be less likely to intrude on you at other points. So that is a really helpful kind of practice to do. So yeah, I'll wait.
This is great. I love that. And
I talk for hours about this stuff, but
no, absolutely. No, we should. I me too. I am so. This conversation is so amazing. I'm learning so much and so practical. And I think what you just, I'm just going to double down on that. Like what you said, I totally believe that. And I've never heard this before, but I totally believe it, that if you do it like, you know, as a practice, like you start doing it and don't expect results right away, just like practice. That's the key.
Yes. It's the routine of it. You're building new learning, a new mental muscle.
And it's
muscle.
Kind of, again, the same thing we talked about a little bit before, like, you know, it's the key is like the behavioral component, right? Like having a specific behavior that you do or not. It's like, yeah. Anyway, I'm drifting off a little bit in my thought, but anyway, I have a couple of more things that I really want to talk about. And this is a big one. So lately I feel over the past few weeks or so that, let me give you the full thing here. So I've come to regard CBTI as like almost like two phases, if you will. Like the early phase is like, you know, educating people about general sleep, you know, sleep physiology, sleep drive, you know, bedtime restriction or sleep restriction, stimulus control, those things. And when people understand that, then the whole next phase is just about like shifting attention away from sleep because of what we talked about. Like even if you're just a little bit preoccupied, that leads you to think more about it, you become more anxious, worried, and you sleep less. So So I feel like almost the holy grail for me now is like thinking about like, how can I get people to like shift away attention away from sleep and insomnia? And I have like one thing that I've been experiencing that I'm telling you about in a second, but what are your thoughts on that?
I, as usual, Daniel, we are 100% in agreement here. I completely agree with you. The way to get out of insomnia ultimately is to not have it be a thing that you even think about anymore, that you don't do anything about. Again, going back to that idea of sleep effort. So for instance, I will, at a certain point in my treatment with people, I have people stop doing sleep diaries, which is like a cornerstone of CBTI. Sometimes I don't even do it with people because it promotes too much sleep effort. It keeps people thinking about their sleep too much. And to your brain, to the fear center of your brain, to your amygdala, if it always sees you thinking about and kind of worried about and trying to fix your sleep, you're perpetuating this belief that your sleep, that there's a danger there, that something's wrong, right? Which is going to keep you in this state of arousal and anxiety about your sleep, which is really the whole problem with insomnia, is that you're too aroused.
Let me just sneak this one quickly in here. Like when you talked about like the different stages in turbo, my thought was also going like, you know, what we're talking about now, a lot of people are in this turbo mode, like all the time.
Yep. No, absolutely. And it's incompatible. You cannot be in sixth gear and in park at the same time.
Right. So what are your thoughts? Like how do you get out of that?
So I have actually, with clients in my clinical practice, something that this is very informal and I've never seen research on this, but when I feel like people are at that stage, when they kind of, they know all the stuff, they're doing a pretty good job of implementing the best practices of CBTI, and their sleep has improved to some degree, not to where they would like it necessarily. What I will often talk to them about explicitly is, I say, hey, let's do this experiment. Let's pick a different topic for therapy for a couple months and let's see what happens to your sleep. Right. So I just had a client where we switched to, he had some stuff he wanted to work on in terms of his marriage and communication and stuff with his spouse. So we completely dropped any talk about his sleep or insomnia or anything for 2 months. And we got to 7 weeks, and he came in and he was like, I know we said 2 months, but I am just too excited because my sleep is way better. Like not talking about it in therapy gave me permission to stop thinking about it and worrying about it in my life. And the result was that he started sleeping better.
Amazing. And then he's sleeping better. Like he sees that he can sleep. He builds his sleep confidence. Like, right?
Okay. Boom. That is a really important, I'm glad you brought that up. That is a super important idea, the idea of sleep confidence. And it gets back to what we talked about at the very beginning, which is that the core idea is that fundamentally there's nothing wrong with your body in insomnia, which means getting over insomnia means learning to trust that your body can and will sleep on its own without any help from you. And that's an amazingly, if you can get to that point, there's so much confidence there. So I think that really is the goal here, is to build confidence that you can sleep well enough, on average.
Yeah, exactly. And if you can even get to that point where there people are seeing like, oh, I can sleep, as you put it, well enough, build sleep confidence, then they can actually sleep fantastic, as things go along.
Yeah, right.
And I have two things I want to sneak in here. Which was the first one. It just a little interesting thing from my YouTube channel. I had this person who was emailing back and forth and he had trouble sleeping. And then what happened is he had like food poisoning and all these GI issues. Mm-hmm. And he was dealing with that, going to his doctor, et cetera. And he realized as he was worried more about his GI stuff, his sleep improved. So it's so interesting how even like a negative can be a positive when it comes to like shifting just your attention away. So that was just a little anecdote, and I was going to share this. What I've, been doing lately is like, I've been telling people like, okay, I think you get, most of the basics here, like you're doing well, but all the problem is attention. So give me a list of like one fun, different thing you want to do every day. And like, I'll hold you accountable to it. And I believe that's going to work.
Interesting. Yeah. I like it.
And almost doing a sleep diary or like having a diary of like, completely unrelated to sleep. Like, let's keep a track of like what you're doing for this. So just a little thought there.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. No, that's good.
Let me ask you this one, which, you know, I've come up with my own theory. Like, it was one of those like breakthrough moments. I felt like, oh, I think I get this. But let me curious on this one. A lot of people, when you start talking about, let's say, CBTI and et cetera, are skeptical, understandably. A lot of people have tried like a million things, nothing has worked. But sometimes it's almost as if people are looking for a reason that CBTI is not going to work for them.
Yeah.
And what are your thoughts on that? And why is that? Because sometimes it comes across initially before I think now I'm understanding it. But initially I was like, why is it? Like, why are you looking for a reason this is not going to work?
So one thing I have found, and this is sort of can be a delicate topic, so I want to try and be mindful of being sensitive to people who can often have a lot of hard things going on in their life that contribute to this. But one of the things I see a lot is what I call scapegoating sleep. So a lot of people will come in and say, well, the reason they want to get better sleep is because they're exhausted during the day, they're just cranky, they don't have the same kind of energy levels or focus that they want, they just don't feel as connected with, you know, the people in their life, their spouse, their family, and they just feel kind of like blah, you know. And it's true that if you really are getting poor quality sleep night after night after night, that can contribute to you feeling low energy, low enthusiasm, more irritability, low mood, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But there's a million and one other things that can also lead to that kind of stuff. So if you're finding yourself, you know, having a hard time getting out of bed and just not having much energy in the morning and not having much enthusiasm or having a hard time focusing on your work, well, something I see a lot is people coming into my office for insomnia. And yes, they have some things they need to work out with their sleep. But what we really discover is they hate their job. They hate it. They hate it.
Yeah.
They really just despise it. They don't like doing it. So if you hate your job, the thing you do every single day for 8 hours, you think maybe that could be playing a role in the fact that you have a hard time getting up out of bed because, God, I got to go do this thing I hate for 8 hours and that I don't feel very energized or enthusiastic or that I have a hard time focusing and I get distracted on other things. So it's really important to look at when you're talking about overall how you feel and how that's related to sleep. There's sort of a pie chart here where, yes, sleep is an important component of how you feel throughout the day, including energy levels and how rested or not you feel. But there are a lot of other things that go into overall how you feel throughout the day. And it's really worth looking at what are those other, you know, what's my exercise regimen like? What's my diet like? What are my interpersonal relationships like in the most important relationships in my life? What's my work life like? You know, what's my spiritual life like? There can be issues in all of those areas. And sometimes those areas are really intimidating or hard for people to even imagine starting to change or work through.
Right, right.
So they sort of it's hard to say this without sounding insensitive, but I think on a kind of not totally conscious level, we put all the blame onto sleep.
Yeah.
And all the expectation. Like, if only I was sleeping 8 hours instead of 7 hours. I'd feel super energetic and I'd love my job and I'd have great relationships with my wife. And, you know, like it's a little unrealistic, like, because there's so many other things that contribute to your overall, how you feel throughout the day. I mean, sleep's a big part of it, but it's by no means the only part. And so that's a long-winded answer to your question, but that is something, that's a dynamic I see play out time after time with a lot of my clients.
Now, it's funny timing. I just made this kind of like voice reply to one of the emails I got, and I think I touched upon something very similar. Like, I think it's a psychological term. I read it in some book or something. But is it called all or nothing? Right? That oftentimes when sleep, it's like people feel like everything, 100% of how they feel is attributed to sleep, like the all. But it's not all or nothing. You know,
all or nothing thinking or black and white thinking. Right, yeah,
exactly. Black and white. Exactly.
Right. Yeah, I often do as an exercise with my clients. I'll go up to the whiteboard and we'll draw a circle and create a pie chart. And I'll say, okay, this is the pie chart of your energy levels throughout the day. And we'll draw like a wedge that's maybe like a third, right? Or even like a half of the pie chart. And we'll call that sleep. But then we start drawing in, well, what are the
other... What else could it be, right?
Yeah, what else contributes to your energy levels throughout the day? like, how stressed are you? How excited are you for work? You know, like, what's your diet like? When was the last time you exercised? You know, like, all these, and it's kind of a revelation for people when they realize, oh yeah, God, I'm putting a lot of pressure on sleep to basically fix everything in my life. And not only is that unrealistic, there's a lot of other things that contribute to your overall quality of life besides sleep, but that added pressure on sleep only makes it harder to sleep.
Exactly.
It's sleep effort and sleep anxiety, right? So taking some of that pressure and expectation for those other elements of your life, including things like overall restedness and fatigue and energy levels, and not putting all of that on your sleep, I think is actually a really important idea.
100%. Absolutely. And, you know, as you were talking about, I visualized that pie chart, and I think it's so strong when you realize, okay, I'm putting 100% effort on something that only has 30% impact, right? You know?
Yep.
So,
and then you're just adding, because it's not working, because that's not the only thing that affects it, you're adding frustration into the mix, right? And you're getting frustrated and angry with yourself and with your therapist and with the stupid CBTI thing and like, why isn't it working? And well, it's because there's more to the story. It's not that black or white. It's not that all or nothing. So I think that's a great point, Daniel.
Really good one. Listen, I think we'll wrap up here. It was super. We've been talking 40 minutes. I think it's really, really valuable stuff here. So I want to thank you again, Nick, or unless you have anything to add.
No, thanks for having me on, Daniel. This is, as always, it's a great discussion. I hope I didn't dominate the conversation too much.
Not at all. I'm super grateful, and hope you'll come on again soon.
Yeah, you bet.
Okay, Nick. Thank you.